Is there an audio quality difference between 24-bit linear and 32-bit float audio recordings when you're doing spoken word audio? Well, let's listen to some samples and see what we can learn here. It was easier to know it than to explain why I know it. If you were asked to prove that 2 and 2 made 4, you might find some difficulty, and yet you are quite sure of the fact. It was easier to know it than to explain why I know it. If you were asked to prove that 2 and 2 made 4, you might find some difficulty, and yet you are quite sure of the fact. It was easier to know it than to explain why I know it. If you were asked to prove that 2 and 2 made 4, you might find some difficulty, and yet you are quite sure of the fact. It was easier to know it than to explain why I know it. If you were asked to prove that 2 and 2 made 4, you might find some difficulty, and yet you are quite sure of the fact. It was easier to know it than to explain why I know it. If you were asked to prove that 2 and 2 made 4, you might find some difficulty, and yet you are quite sure of the fact. It was easier to know it than to explain why I know it. If you were asked to prove that 2 and 2 made 4, you might find some difficulty, and yet you are quite sure of the fact. We'll talk more about those samples in just a minute, but first of all, what is 32-bit float recording? Well, first of all, I think it's kind of an unfortunate name that a lot of product companies that make audio recorders have started using to describe their technology. 32-bit float is part of the technology. It is basically the format in which they save the audio or encode the audio into a WAV file, but it isn't the full description. So really, what 32-bit float is, it's just a way to record a wider dynamic range. And dynamic range is, of course, the range between the quietest sounds and the loudest sounds. That's all that 32-bit float enables. But it requires more than that to really get the most out of it, to really record wide dynamic range. As an example, think about soft rain falling on asphalt and then a lightning bolt striking and you hear the thunder. That would be a very, very wide dynamic range of sound. And the beauty is that 32-bit float containers or files or encoding schemes can record really, really wide dynamic range like that. But to do that, there are a couple of things. Number one is the microphone. The microphone has to be able to handle as wide a dynamic range as well. So it's really great that these recorders can handle a wider dynamic range and encode them in 32-bit float. But if you don't have a microphone that can handle the sound pressure levels or the wide dynamic range of what you're trying to capture, then you're still going to get some distortion, but it's going to happen at the microphone before it ever gets to the recorder. So that's the first thing. Secondly, there are some other things that are necessary to get wide dynamic range recording. And typically what these wide dynamic range recorders do, something like a Zoom F6 or a Zoom F8N Pro or a SoundDevices MixPre 2 series recorder, they have multiple analog to digital converters. So just very quickly, a microphone captures audio and it creates an analog electrical signal that goes into your recorder. And then the recorder converts that electrical signal. Well, first of all, before it does that, it amplifies the signal using a preamplifier, makes it louder, and then it converts it into digital from analog. So to capture this very wide dynamic range, what recorders, these wide dynamic range recorders do is they have multiple analog to digital converters per input. And so what those converters do is one of them, for example, and they can have two, they can have three, they can have even more than that, but one of them, as an example, will handle the very, very loud sounds, and the other one will handle the quieter sounds. And then it will bring those back together and encode them into a 32-bit float space. So that's how these work, and those are all the different ingredients that have to be there. So it's really important you need to understand, number one, which microphone you use makes a big, big difference. Number two, the placement of the microphone matters a lot. And so I remember when 32-bit float recorders first came out, people were saying, oh, a bunch of people are going to lose their jobs. These production sound mixers aren't going to be needed anymore. I don't think that's the case at all. I think it's just a tool that makes their jobs potentially easier. And honestly, most production sound mixers aren't using 32-bit float recorders normally for capturing dialogue, but they can. But in any case, getting the right microphone that can handle the sound pressure levels and the dynamic range you're trying to capture is one important factor. Then having this wide dynamic range recording capability on your recorder is another factor. So it's not quite so simple. And honestly, I wish they'd call them wide dynamic range audio recorders as opposed to 32-bit float recorders, because you see, it's not just 32-bit float. It also requires multiple analog to digital converters. So that's another factor. Now, the interesting thing about 32-bit float as well is that 32-bit float, while it can manage a much wider dynamic range, it can provide a much wider range of values to store the audio in, it's very much like scientific notation or using exponents. So you can represent very large or very small numbers. However, when you do that, at some point you lose precision and there are potential precision errors. And so the big question for me is, using 32-bit float to encode your audio, does that reduce the audio quality of what you're hearing? And from the samples that we heard here for spoken word audio, I honestly think that we're not really pushing the limits of the microphone or the recorder that much that it makes a difference. I think for sound effects, the answer may be entirely different. But for spoken word audio, and what we did specifically for those 32-bit float recordings is we intentionally set the gain or the input level, or in the case of the Zoom F6, we set the fader so that it would intentionally get the audio above 0 dB full scale, which is kind of like the big magic of 32-bit float audio. When you first see a demonstration of this, when there's audio that hits up against 0 dB and that you can actually reduce the level of the audio and you can actually restore the quality of the audio, that seems like magic to people. And indeed, it's something we're not used to, and it is, I guess, kind of magical. But if you understand it, it makes sense how it's possible. In my experience listening to those samples and with other samples that I've listened to, I think what matters more, I don't really feel like the 32-bit float recordings were substantially worse than the 24-bit. I don't think the 24-bit recordings were substantially better than the 32-bit float recordings. But I think what is a bigger difference is the choice of microphone that you use, where you place the microphone, and that you're using a quality recorder that has good preamplifiers, quality preamplifiers, and quality analog to digital converters. Of all those samples, the only one that sounded really kind of substantially different to me was especially when we recorded with the Rode NT1 5th generation, which is a XLR and USB microphone. And incidentally, we use the same microphone through all of those samples intentionally. So the analog front end of that microphone is the same through all those samples. What I noticed was that when we recorded with the USB connection on the NT1 5th generation, that means we're actually using a preamplifier and analog to digital converters inside the microphone. And in that case, it sounded not quite as smooth as the others to me, but I think that's not so much an issue of 32-bit float versus 24-bit linear. That's more an issue of the preamplifier and the analog to digital converters that they're using. So all of this to say, I think for spoken word audio, 32-bit float is fine. I don't think some people call it a game changer. It hasn't changed my game much. I still record mostly in 24-bit because I mostly recorded things that are scripted and or in controlled environments where I know what's coming. But if you're recording some sort of situation where you've given the actor full freedom to do whatever they want and it's unscripted in some way, or maybe you're working on a horror film where there are going to be whispers to screams all in the same take, those are cases where it may be useful. But I think it's important to keep in mind, you will also have to do work in post to bring that into a range that actually can be mastered and sent out in your final video. So those are some things to keep in mind as well. But in short, I think it's fine to use 32-bit float for spoken word audio for your own projects. If you're working on a project with other people involved, make sure that they can handle 32-bit float in the overall workflow in the pipeline so that you're not giving them something they can't work with. And if you can't afford a 32-bit float recorder, a quality 32-bit float recorder, you're going to be fine. Your audio is not going to be worse for it. Just learn how to set your input level, your gain, and you'll be fine. I think one thing to consider as well, there are a bunch of these body pack recorders on the market that are 32-bit float capable as well. So they're wide dynamic range recorders, but they come bundled with a lavalier microphone. A few things about lavalier microphones. First of all, the microphones that are bundled with those kits usually are not very good. They're okay, but they're not amazing. And secondly, lavalier microphones by nature and by design are not generally capable of handling as wide a dynamic range as a more capable microphone. So for example, like the Rode NT1 5th generation here, for example. So that's an important thing to keep in mind. If you're expecting that you can go out and record jet engines to softly pattering rain on a piece of concrete somewhere with that lavalier microphone, maybe not. I also noticed that most of those microphones sound a little bit brittle. So just some things to keep in mind there as well. I think beyond the consideration of whether 32-bit float or 24-bit linear sounds better as a recording, there are a lot of other factors that matter. So as a final word here, get out there, make some great sound. I don't care whether you're doing it in 32-bit float or 24-bit. Just get out there, get your message out, and have a good time doing it. We'll talk to you soon.